Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a free, complete course for the CCNA. If you like these videos, please subscribe to follow along with the series. Also, please like and leave a comment, and share the video to help spread this free series of videos. Thanks for your help. Also, remember to sign up via the link in the description to get all of the lab files for this course, so you can try it out yourself in Packet Tracer. If you want more labs like these, I highly recommend picking up Boson's NetSim for the CCNA. Click the link in the video description to check it out. It's a network simulator like Packet Tracer, but it's even better, and it includes all of these guided labs to not only help you get hands-on practice, configuring and troubleshooting, but also deepen your understanding of the exam topics. I used it myself when studying for my certifications, so I feel confident about recommending it to all of you. If you want to get your own copy of NetSim, please follow the link in the video description. In today's video, we'll practice configuring IPv6 static routes in this network to enable PC1 and PC2 to ping each other via the R1-R3 path, and also configure a backup route via R2. The IPv6 addresses on the routers have been pre-configured, but not the PCs, so we are going to use Slack to configure IPv6 addresses on the PCs. Before that, we must enable IPv6 routing on each router. If IPv6 routing isn't enabled, these routers won't route IPv6 traffic, and they also won't send the NDP router advertisement messages that are necessary for Slack to work. So let's quickly enable that on each router. R1 first. Enable conft IPv6 unicast routing. Next, R2. Enable conft IPv6 unicast routing. Finally, R3. Enable conft IPv6 unicast routing. Okay, always remember that step when configuring IPv6. Now I'll go on PC1. From the config tab, I'll set the default gateway by clicking on automatic. As you can see, PC1 automatically set its default gateway. This is a link local IPv6 address, so it must be R1's address. It learned it from R1's NDP router advertisement messages. Next, I'll select PC1's Fast Ethernet 0 interface. And you can see Packet Tracer automatically enabled Slack for PC1, and it configured an IPv6 address. It learned this network prefix from R1, and the second half, the interface ID, was generated using EUI64. Okay, let's do the same on PC2. From the config tab, tell PC2 to automatically learn its default gateway. There it is, and let's look at its Fast Ethernet 0 interface. As you can see, it automatically learned the network prefix from R3, and also used EUI64 to generate an interface ID. Later, when I try a ping from PC1 to PC2, I'm going to need to copy this address, but I can't highlight it here. So I'll go to the CLI of PC2, and use the command ipconfig to view PC2's IPv6 address. Okay, I'll copy this address later when I try to ping from PC1 to PC2. Okay, now let's get to the main part of this lab, configuring IPv6 static routes. We need to configure routes to allow PC1 and PC2 to ping each other. The path from R1 to R3 should be the main path, and the serial connections to R2 should only be used as a backup. So let's configure routes on R1 first. So R1 needs two routes to R3's internal LAN, the main route directly to R3, and a backup route to R2. Let's configure the main route. IPv6 route 2001db8.0.3:/64. That's the destination. Now we can enter either the next hop, or both the exit interface and next hop. As I said in the lecture video, on an Ethernet interface, you can't use just the exit interface, a directly attached static route. You can only use recursive or fully specified static routes. I'll use fully specified routes. G01, 2001db8.0.13:/2. Okay, that's the main route. Now our backup route via R2. I only enabled IPv6 on the serial interfaces. I didn't manually configure any IPv6 addresses, so the routers only have link local addresses. So I need to know R2's link local address to use as the next hop. I'll go on R2. Do show IPv6 interface brief. Okay, there's the link local address of serial 000. I'll copy it and return to R1. Now I'll use the up arrow, delete the interface and next hop, and now the exit interface is S000, and I'll paste R2's link local address as the next hop. Remember, when using a link local address as the next hop, you have to use a fully specified route. You have to include the exit interface too. But this route isn't complete yet. We want to make sure this is only used as a backup. How can we do that? We can configure it as a floating static route. So I will specify the administrative distance here. Let's make it 5. In Cisco iOS, a normal static route has an AD of 1, so we just need to make the AD higher than 1. Okay, let's check the routing table. Do show IPv6 route. Okay, so you can only see the route via R3, but let's check the running config to make sure R1 has that floating static route. Do show run pipe include IPv6 route. Notice I use the pipe with include to filter it only to lines that include IPv6 route. Okay, now we can see both of the routes. That's all for R1. Now I'm going to configure R2's routes next. So let me get the link local address of R1's S000 interface first. Do show IPv6 interface brief. Okay, I'll copy that to use as the next hop for R2. So let's go back to R2. R2 needs a route to R1's LAN and a route to R3's LAN. I'll configure the route to R1's LAN first. IPv6 route 2001db801:64 S000, and now I'll paste R1's link local address. Okay, next up is the route to R3's LAN. First, I'll go on R3 and get the link local address of its S000 interface. Do show IPv6 interface brief. There it is. Let me copy that. Now I'll go back to R2 and configure the route. IPv6 route 2001db803:64 S001, and I'll paste in R3's link local address as the next hop. Let's check R2's routing table. Do show IPv6 route. Okay, it's got the two static routes we just configured. That's all for R2. But before going to R3, let's get the link local address of R2's S001 interface. Do show IPv6 interface brief. Okay, I'll copy that address. Finally, let's configure R3's routes. First, I'll configure the main route via R1. IPv6 route 2001db801:64 G01 2001db813:1. Note that you don't have to use fully specified routes like I do. You can use just the next hop. Okay, now the backup route via R2. I'll use the up arrow, delete the interface and next hop, and now the interface will be S000. I'll paste in R2's link local address, and finally set the AD to 5. Okay, that's everything. PC1 should be able to ping PC2, and there is a backup route in case the link between R1 and R3 fails. Let's try that ping. I'll go to PC2 first to copy its IP address. Next, I'll go on to the CLI of PC1, and let's try that ping to PC2. Ping, and I'll paste in PC2's IP address. Okay, PC1 is able to ping PC2. Let's try a trace route to see which path it is taking. On a Windows PC, the command is trace RT, but if you're doing this command on a Cisco device, you'll have to type it out fully like this, trace route. These packet tracer PCs are like Windows PCs, so it's just trace RT. And again, I'll paste PC2's address. Okay, it goes to the default gateway, then 13:2, which is R3, and then the destination. Okay, let's unplug that cable between R1 and R3. To delete the cable, click this icon in Packet Tracer, then click the cable. Okay, now it's deleted. Let's try that ping again from PC1. I'll use the up arrow, and let's try it. Okay, it works. How about a traceroute? As you can see, the traceroute is having trouble at the second hop, at R2. That's because R2 only has link local addresses, which aren't routable. But if we wait a bit, we see a reply from R3, and then the destination, PC2. Don't worry about that. The ping is still working, and the PCs have no problems reaching each other. It's no problem if PC1 can't reach every single router in the path to the destination. Okay, in this lab we configured IPv6 static routes. That's all for this lab. Okay, here's today's Boson NetSim practice lab. This lab is configuring IPv6 too. Here's the objective. Configure a simulated network with IPv6 addresses on physical interfaces and loopback interfaces. Your implementation should enable router interfaces to ping IPv6 addresses across routers and across IPv6 subnets. And you will configure IPv6 addressing and routing information protocol, RIP, for IPv6. So, you will configure RIP for IPv6 in this lab. As I have said before, dynamic routing protocols for IPv6 aren't actually part of the CCNA exam topics list, but the configuration is actually quite simple, so let's give it a try. And you can check down here in the command summary which commands you need to know to complete this lab. Okay, here are the lab tasks. Task 1, configure IPv6 addresses. Task 2, enable IPv6 RIP routing. And task 3, configure IPv6 between router 1 and router 3. So for this lab demonstration, I actually completed task 1. I configured IPv6 addresses on router 3 and router 4. I configured two loopback interfaces. As you can see here in the CLI of router 3, loopback 6, I configured IPv6 addresses. And same on router 4, loopback 6, IPv6 addresses. So finally, just this last step in task 1, step 10, from router 4, try to ping router 3's global unicast serial 01 IPv6 address. So that should work. Let's try. Ping 2001.131:1. Oh, I am in interface configuration mode. I'll just exit out of there and try that once again. Okay, the ping works. And then it says to try to ping router 3's global unicast loopback 6 IPv6 address. So let's try that. I will change this to a 2. And the ping is not working. So why is that? Router 4 can ping the directly connected interface here, but not the loopback interface in router 3. And the answer as to why that is pretty simple. Show IPv6 route here on router 4, and there is no route to the 2001.132 network, which router 3's loopback interface is in. So router 4 simply doesn't know about that network. So we could configure a static route on router 4, and then a static route on router 3 to router 4's loopback interface. But in this lab, we are not going to do that. We are going to use RIPNG, RIP Next Generation. So let's go on to task 2. On router 3 and router 4, globally enable RIP for IPv6, name the process Boson. So we haven't covered RIPNG configuration in the course yet, and we won't because it's not actually in the exam topics list, but you can check how to do that here. IPv6 router RIP process name. So it's said to use a process name of Boson. IPv6 router RIP Boson. Okay, and then router 3. IPv6 router RIP Boson. Okay, that's it. Let me just check. Do show IPv6 protocols. Okay, IPv6 routing protocol is RIP Boson. That doesn't mean rest in peace, Boson, by the way. Boson is alive and well. Okay, step 2. Issue the show IPv6 route command on router 3. What RIP routes are being advertised? Why? Okay. Do show IPv6 route. Okay, I don't see any RIP routes. Why is that? Well, that's because router 4, and also on router 3, we haven't enabled RIP ng directly on the interfaces yet. We've enabled rip, the rip process, on the router, but it's still not activated on any interfaces. Okay, on router 4, try to ping the IPv6 address on router 3's loopback 6 interface. Okay, I'll try that, but I can tell you now that the ping will not succeed. And indeed, it does not, because router 3 isn't advertising any rip routes yet. Okay, so now we are going to enable rip on the interfaces. So you can see the command how to do that up here. IPv6 rip, process name enable, on the interface. So on router 4, that is serial 00 first. IPv6 rip, boson, right? Enable. Okay, that was it. And then the loopback 6 interface, IPv6 rip, boson, enable. Okay, that's all for R4. Now let's do it on R3. Interface S01, IPv6 rip, boson, enable, and on loopback 6. Okay, that should be it. Let's go back to task 2. Allow time for the network to converge. So rip can be kind of slow, so we gotta wait for them to learn the routes. And then issue the show IPv6 route command on router 3. Do you see a route from router 3 to router 4's loopback 6 interface? Hopefully that was enough time, let's check. Do show IPv6 route. And yes, this should be router 4's loopback 6 interface. On router 4, attempt to ping router 3's loopback interface. Okay, let's try that. Do ping 2001.132:1. Okay, and the ping works. So that means router 4 also has a route to router 3's loopback interface. And here it is. Oh. Right there. Okay, on router 3, issue the show IPv6 protocols command. You should note that router 3 is sending and receiving updates on the serial 01 interface by using the rip boson process. Okay, we saw that command earlier, but let's check it again now. IPv6 routing protocol is rip boson, and there it is. Note that the loopback 6 interface isn't displayed, just the serial interface. Okay, so in task 3, you would go on to configure IPv6 here between router 1 and router 3, but for today's lab demonstration, we'll leave it here. So if you want to get a copy of Boson NetSim for yourself, please follow the link in the video description. Before finishing today's video, I want to thank my JCNP level channel members. To join, please click the Join button under the video. Thank you to OJ, Magrathia, The Gun Guy, L33 America, Brandon, Njabalo, Benjamin, Tsepiso, Justin, Neil, Prakash, Nasir, Erlison, Apogee, Wasim, Marco, Flodo, Daming, Joshua, Gilmar, Samil, Ed, Value, John, Funny Dart, Scott, Hassan, Marek, Velajakum, C-Mode, Mark, Yusuf, CD, Boson Software, Devin, Lito, Jonathan, and Vance. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. This is the list of JCNP level members at the time of recording, by the way, November 8th, 2020. If you signed up recently and your name isn't on here, don't worry. You'll be in future videos. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe to the channel, like the video, leave a comment, and share the video with anyone else studying for the CCNA. If you want to leave a tip, check the links in the description. I'm also a Brave verified publisher and accept BAT or Basic Attention Token tips via the Brave browser. That's all for now.